Welcome back to the Saga of Sophie. This is episode 3. And this episode, we are going to go through and clean all of her internal components. And it unfortunately took me a lot longer to get this shot than I had anticipated. During the holiday season, at my day job, doing anything beyond the actual job is a bit of a challenge because we've got people out on vacation, so work winds up being doubly busy. And one week, actually, I wound up working the Asia Pacific shift, which, if you've ever changed shifts in the middle of the stream, I know it just screws up my sleep cycle, and I couldn't get anything done during the day. So, anyway, enough of the excuses. This is going to be a long episode. Some of this is going to be voiced over and sped up because otherwise it would last 5 hours. And some of it's going to be sound as it was recorded. I did go in depth on fastener cleaning once again. I know I've shown it in the past. I haven't shown it lately. And I think I got a better camera angle this time than I have in past attempts at doing that. But anyway, a cup of coffee is not going to make it. You're going to need to put a pot on for this one. So grab yourself a bagel with a schmear and let's get going. Welcome back to the Saga of Sophie. This is going to be part 3. We're going to start looking at her parts and getting this stuff cleaned. There's a few things that was set off to the side for the moment. We'll do that separate. Certain things I'm not overly concerned about right now. I'm just putting off to the side. What I'm worried about is basically this stuff here. So let's develop a strategy on how we're going to attack this, shall we? Before we go too much further along, I had tried cleaning some of these internal parts with my inexpensive Harbor Freight ultrasonic cleaner. That was woefully inadequate for the task at hand. That thing is a single transducer unit, limited power, and it just doesn't have enough guts to do the cleaning on something as dirty as what Sophie was. And I tried a couple of different solvents, or I should say cleaning solutions. Anyway, it didn't make it. So that machine has been retired, or at least from this kind of work. Liz and I have ordered a new ultrasonic. It's a 15 liter with 6 transducers, which should have gobs of power to clean these kind of parts, but it's way too late for this project. It won't even be here for a few more weeks yet. But anyway, so suffice it to say that you're going to see some parts that are already kind of clean, and kind of clean is a relative term. Some of the crud came off. Some of the crud was just converted into a different form of crud. So it was like a crud transformation happened. But anyway, we'll pick it up from there. Here's the stop motion bushing from Sophie. She's all nice and cleaned and polished all the way around. Now, how I got it clean, what I did was I used a rotary tool with a stainless steel wire brush to knock the majority of the schmoo off of it. And then I took it to the buffing wheel, and I have this old main shaft out of a 201. I just put the bushing on the main shaft. I didn't screw it in place or anything. I just put it on there just to give it, just so something could hold on to it. And I took it to the buff, and as the buffing wheel is coming along polishing, I could rotate it around, and it basically supported it. It kept my fingers out of the buffing wheel. When I got this end of it all done, I pulled it off, flipped it around so I could get this side of it. And as you can see, that's nice and clean. So this is going to be the first piece that goes back on Sophie. So what I'm going to do is up at the other end of the machine, up at the nose, I'm gripping that and I'm sticking a couple of fingers holding that cam in place. And I'm going to line up the hole where the screw goes and then just eyeball where this hole is. Now this is not drilled all the way through like ones that are, many of them that are pinned. So a word to the wise, if you're going to have to replace one of these bushings, there's a bunch of different bushings out there. Make sure you get the correct one. Actually, I can show you an incorrect one, although it looks very much like it. Notice, let me pull that off. This one has a hole drilled all the way through, but notice how far off the big end holes are. I'm not exactly sure what that came off of. It might have been a 15, but it's definitely not the right one for Sophie. So anyway, I'm getting that lined up. I'm going to use a plastic mallet. Get it a little closer to alignment. I'm just going to lightly tap it while I'm holding the cam end in place with my left hand. And I can see that that's not quite straight. See, at this stage of the game, because this is so clean inside and out, I can lightly turn that ever so slightly before it gets all the way in. Just lightly tap, tap, tap. Like I said, I'm not really hitting this hard at all. Just very lightly tapping it. Using a plastic face mallet. I can see that's off a little bit. I can twist that probably if I'm lucky. Yep, able to twist it. It's off just a schneck. Then the farther you put it on, the harder it is to turn. Just keep that in mind. There we go. And I'm going to center up the two holes. And I think I've pretty much got that accomplished. And get the retaining screw in place. So there we go. Stop motion bushing is on. Maybe a thou or so in place. Just put the balance wheel on for a moment. You can see this nice and freely moving there. So that's going to be just fine. We're going to start out using the rotary tool and the Scotch-Brite buffing tools on there, or I should say cleaning tools. The brown one, which I've got on at the moment, or at least that's what they call it, it's actually more of a yellowish color, that's at 120 grit. There's also a green at 180, a red at 320, and a black at 400. I've shown these before. These little rotary Scotch Brites are great for getting crud off of some of these smaller parts. That's the needle bar bushing there. You see me getting a lot of the schmoo off of that. That'll eventually go to the buffing wheel and get cleaned and polished the rest of the way. Likewise, using it on the thread take-up arm, it's great for getting into those small areas. And see, you switched over to a 180 grit green here. They're tremendously helpful. They're not super expensive. They don't last all that long, but you know, you can get quite a bit of life out of each wheel. And of course, the wire wheel, which I use quite often. I get those at Harbor Freight. And you'll see I've got, actually got multiple rotary tools here. Now you might be wondering, what's with the block of wood? Well, I use the block of wood to support what I'm
polishing or sometimes even just wire wheeling, sometimes if you can grab an item, you know, grab a part with your hand and just hold it up tight against a block of wood, it helps stabilize it for you. And I'm going to show you a little bit later on some of the other things I do with that block of wood, which, granted, that little piece of 2x3 is getting pretty old and it's really funky. I really should cut another chunk off for myself. But here we're just going to go along. That's the transfer fork. Once again, I'm using the block of wood to hold it, hold against it to support it. And there's the bell crank assembly. Now, that went out to the garage and got cleaned with the 6-inch wire wheel on the bench grinder. That had so much crud on it, I couldn't get that off with a rotary tool. But I use a very fine wire wheel on the bench grinder when I'm using those. Now I'm taking a hard felt polishing point. I'm going to get in the inside the hole where the bell crank pivots on. And if you're wondering, yeah, I'm using a white polishing compound with this. I've got a big block of it in a drawer on my bench there, and I reach down occasionally and recharge the polishing tool that I'm using. And as always, just, you know, take a piece of paper towel. I'm just using regular kitchen type paper towels for this today. And wipe the schmoo off as you go. That's the lifting arm for the bell crank. Feed dog, excuse me. And you'll notice I'm putting a smaller one on so I can get into the pivot point on that. I'll use those same small ones for many of the other smaller pivot points on the machine. And going in with some cotton swabs to clean out the buffing dirt. The red stuff in the needle oiler there is regular croil, not the aerosol version, obviously. And those bearings that are on the like the lifter arm and on the end of the feed dog rock shaft, those bearings can get stuck quite often and kind of seize up. You put a little bit of croil on there, and that'll help soak them out. And we'll go back later on and we're going to be flushing that out to get the rest of the crap out. What I'm working on there, that was the basket for the upper thread tension assembly. And what are we doing next? Ah, getting some parts out of the way that are going to wind up going into the other shop and take to the buffer. And I'm going to take some of the crud off the slack thread regulator. And that looks like I'm taking crud off of the bearing for the arm for the stitch length regulator. Now, when I said about using the block of wood, this is going to be a good example of it. That's the lifting arm for the presser bar. And you see that I'm holding it up against that block of wood while I'm using the rotary tool to polish this. You're going to see also coming up pretty soon that I'm going to use the block of wood to jig that part too. Taking a tapered punch, I've got a couple of holes drilled in various places on that block, and putting the tapered punch through the hole in the arm, I'm able to use that punch to help stabilize the arm and to hold the arm flat onto the block. So, you know, it's like jigging the work. You know, switch to a cylinder here. It makes it a lot easier. Now, keep in mind, when you're buffing, a lot of this, you know, especially because you're working with compounds, there's a lot of friction involved. And with friction comes what? Heat. These parts can get extremely hot. So finding good work holding methods and ways to jig your parts sometimes makes all the difference in the world when you're polishing. Yeah, and if you couldn't tell, this footage has been sped up quite a bit. Some of this is sped up 400 or 300%. Now here, I'm at the buffing wheel, and I'm using a presser bar, an extra presser bar I have, as a jig to hold the presser bar spring so I can clean and polish it off. There's a couple things here I show that's a good way of doing things and things not to do. Coming up pretty soon is going to be a not to do. But what I'm doing here is I'm using the presser bar to support the spring. That way I can just rotate the spring around with my fingers while holding the presser bar. Now, don't do this. That's a no. Don't do that. If you're going to clean the end, support it with the presser bar. Okay? And then you can flip it around and do the other side too. Don't hold it without supporting it to clean the ends. You're just asking for trouble. That's a 5-inch spiral sewn chamois wheel. Now, as I'm doing a side clamping conversion on Sophie, this is the replacement presser bar that I'm going to be using for that. I went through my stock of presser bars and needle bars till I found one that looked like it's going to fit. I checked it on her. It's going to be just fine. I'm not actually 100% sure what machine this came out of. It might not have even been a Singer. This might have been out of a Japanese clone for all I know. All I know is it's a good length and it will work. And now I'm flipping around to do the other side. That's the yellow compound I use on this wheel. But I flip it around and I do multiple. I work different areas because once again, with buffing, we generate heat. And this can get awful hot, awful fast. We just work on it, getting the schmoo off. This wasn't too dirty to begin with. The needle bar that actually came off of Sophie was disgusting. But you'll see that coming up soon. And a little piece of paper towel to wipe off some of the buffing dirt. It's a little late. Most of the buffing dirt's on my hands at this point. But I'm using that. That helps insulate me a little bit from the amount of heat that's coming back through that that presser bar as I work the middle section now. Once again, I've mentioned this before, that's a Fariz N99 motor, bench motor, with one of their tapered spindles and the chamois wheel. Now here you see the needle bar. This is the top end of the needle bar. You'll notice I'm going through and I'm getting this cleaned first. And I'm only doing a small section of it. Just the top end, and you will see why. Let me get the top clean. And there we go. Wipe off some of the schmoo. Now the next thing I'm going to do is I'm putting on the needle bar clamp, not the needle clamp, the needle bar clamp. I'm putting it in so the screw goes into the machined groove, and I'm using the needle bar now as my fixture, as my jig to hold the needle bar clamp so I can buff it clean, buff it shiny. So yeah, now I'm probably not even going to wind up using this clamp. I thought about this afterwards. I'm going to be putting in a gauge that this machine didn't come equipped with. And rather than scoring that particular clamp, I'm probably just going to grab a clamp that I have that's already got the marks on it. But at least you can see here a way of holding your work, fixturing your work, using another part of the machine, so you can do your buffing. Once again, these parts get extremely hot when you're doing this buffing. Now, you also might see some things here that are contrary to what some people would call safe shop practices. If you buy a buffing machine, read the safety instructions that come with it. Follow them. Don't necessarily do exactly what I do. Do what the manual tells you is safe. There are certain things, certain safety rules that I am breaking here, and I know people are going to beat me up in the comments for it, and I'm perfectly willing to take that beating. So this is a case of do as I say, not as I do. All right, so we got the needle bar clamp that we're not going to be using. We got that cleaned. And the next thing we're going to do is we're going to work on the business end of the needle bar. We'll get this cleaned. Why are we doing that? Well, as you're going to see coming up very shortly, the next thing we're going to do after this section is cleaned is clean the needle clamp. But I kind of like to get the bar clean underneath it first. I really do love this motor. I recently, well, actually about a year ago now, I completely rewired it and I put a new foot pedal on it as well. The foot pedal that I put on, I bought on Amazon. It's a much nicer pedal than what came with the machine from Furiz. But like I said, Liz and I have had this machine. Well, actually, Liz has had this machine for about 30 years. We've got another one out in the other shop as well. They're not cheap. I'll put links to all this stuff. This particular buffing motor is not cheap. And it is aimed at the musical instrument trade, mostly for woodwind work. But it works great for sewing machine stuff as well. Once again, getting that end of the needle bar cleaned up. And wiping off some of the buffing dirt. And next step up is we're going to put that needle clamp on. Get it in position. And we're going to once again use the needle bar as our fixture to polish the clamp. It's the best way I've found to do it. And I get really, really good results with it. Let's put it this way. I haven't had a complaint yet. Now, there are other buffing machines and buffing motors out there. I hate to be always sounding the Harbor Freight, be on the Harbor Freight bandwagon, but Harbor Freight's got a couple of really nice buffing machines. They have a 6-inch, and they recently introduced the Bauer 8-inch. The 8-inch would be overkill, and it might actually be too large, because that one spins at 3,450 RPM. Whereas this is a 1725 RPM motor. But and I think their 6-inch is also a 3450. But keep in mind, the faster the motor spins, the more heat it's going to generate. So you do want to find a slower speed buffing motor, if at all possible. But and you definitely want to run it on a foot switch. You see the difference that made is remarkable. Came up nice and clean, nice and quickly. And now we'll just go ahead, we'll finish getting the rest of that dead crap off of the needle bar. And before anybody says it, yes, I know, I did eventually take a rake to that buffing wheel to clean it off. There's a bit of glazing happening on it there. I didn't show it on camera, but I did take a rake to it. And for the uninitiated, a rake for a buffing wheel, basically it renews the wheel a little bit and removes all the glazing and cuts a lot of the crud off of there. I could have taken this out to the garage and knocked a lot of that off with a very fine wire wheel. But honestly, I don't like doing that to needle bars and depressor bars. I just like to buff them clean. And a little bit of the yellow compound again. Now, the nice thing about this particular style of buffing wheel, it's on a tapered mandrel. I'll put a quick picture up in the corner eventually. But the tapered mandrels, they're set up, well, they come in multiple sizes, and they come in different handing, too, right-hand thread and left-hand thread. The tapered portion of those mandrels is actually one long spiral thread, and that's why you don't see a nut in a washer with that buffing wheel. The natural motion of the buffing wheel pulls it in tight. Now, this is the sliding block for the presser bar. You'll see I'm doing this way, and this was a good way to burn your fingers. That's why I'm showing it like this. Yeah, you can take it to the buffing wheel and buff it like that, but really the better way to do it, at least the better way that I have found to do it, is to put it onto the end of one of your spare presser bars and use the set screw to hold it on nice and snug, and now you've got it fixtured. And you can take it to the buffing wheel, and you can really shine that up and clean it up. And if you're wondering why I'm spending so much time, the flats on that block slide through the cast iron of the machine. And once again, the more crud you get off there, the smoother you get it, the easier it's going to actuate for you. So, you know, whether you do it on a buffing wheel or you do it with a rotary tool, go ahead and shine that part up and get it nice and smooth. And even if you're doing it with a rotary tool, go ahead and jig it on an old presser bar or piece of quarter-inch steel rod, whatever you happen to have. That'll make life a lot simpler for you. Now, here what I'm going after is the bearing for the fork for the stitch length regulator. Now, what I'm showing here is the hard way of doing it. I'm doing that deliberately, showing the hard way. And yeah, that's a pain in the neck. It's not working very well, even though I am jigging it with the fork. And let's clean some of that mess off a little bit before I show you a better way of doing that bearing. So unfortunately, I moved a lot of crap onto there that's going to have to be cleaned off. All right, let's go back over to the bench and grab a rotary tool. Now, this is sped up footage. That's my set of pen punches from Penn State Industries. I grabbed an appropriate size one that bearing will fit on. And once again, using the block, and I've got that punch in there, I've jigged that bearing so I can get the perimeter of it. I'm holding it, I can get the end. With the end cleaned, wipe it off, flip it around, and get the other side. And now that bearing is really, really clean, really well polished, and it's going to really cut down the friction on that part as well. This footage is all sped up once again. Now I'm drilling a hole in my piece of wood. Why? Because I used that as a jig to hold my hook going inside with a, that's actually a chamois buffing wheel, cleaning the inside surface around the perimeter of the hook. Because as you all know, the bobbin case rides on there, and half of the bobbin case is riding on the inside surface of that hook there. But using the block of wood is a way of jigging it in place. And switching over to an appropriate hard felt cone. Get some charge on there. I'm using white compound here again. And getting the inside of those bearing surfaces on the feed dog rock shaft. Getting them nice and clean. Nice and polished, I should say. And then going in with a cotton swab on a wooden stick. That's a larger end one. And really cleaning the crud out of there and then testing what that feels like with a nice cleaned pivot screw. And once again, we have a bearing that always helps to flush with oil. These bearings, like I said earlier, they tend to gum up a lot. So flush them with a lot of oil. Sometimes you have to add a little bit of heat to get them moving again. And there's been many times when I've flushed those with heat and oil and heat and oil and just gotten a lot of crud out of them. And like I said, regular Croil is great for that because it gets in there really well, can flush things out, and then you can eventually just go back and just use some regular sewing machine oil on it. And that one's working a little bit better now. And of course, you know, clean out the extra buffing crud and buffing dirt and any other kind of schmoo that happens to come your way. Now that's the needle bar clamp that secures the needle bar onto the connecting rod. Backing the screw out, go in with a smaller diameter cylindrical hard felt polishing point, and you can clean and polish the inside surface there. And then once you've done that, going up through the screw holes, you can see I've got the screw out, push anything that happened to get in the screw hole out of there. And once again, more swabs. Clean, 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 clean. Just got to go in there with swabs, get the screw back on. I'm going to lubricate those threads up a little bit. Get a little bit of a Croil on there. And that's just cleaning the threads out a little bit. And once again, back through, more cotton swab action, and that's pretty much done. Just wipe her down. Now here's another case of using a hole. That's the offset pivoting arm that moves the connecting rod that moves the needle bar. Notice I've got that into a hole that's pretty much a good snug press fit on the block, so I can take a steel, a wire brush to it to get a lot of the crud off. And flip it around and wire brush some more, removing all of that nasty old oil and crud. All the dried crap. And then we'll go back with a polishing tool. That's a hard felt polishing wheel, by the way. And we'll just go through and we'll just polish that sucker up. If she works pretty, she should look pretty. Just remember that. Now granted, that section there that I'm cleaning is not going to be pivoting while the machine's moving, but just to keep the schmoo to a minimum. It'll help the next guy who has to disassemble it if those parts are cleaned. Hopefully the next guy to disassemble this thing is going to be like in another 100 years. And once again, using the block to support the connecting rod. Now I could grab one of my punches from my pen disassembly set to help support this. I didn't do that. I had already gotten a good portion of the nastiness off of this. This was just a... It doesn't look like it, but this is actually just a light polishing I'm doing on that connecting rod at the moment. There wasn't a tremendous amount of work. Let's see what we have next. Oh, that's part of the stitch length regulator. Just wanted to get some of the schmoo out of there. I had cleaned it on the steel, on the wire brush in the garage shop earlier. Okay, and yes, taking the presser bar and putting that god-awful thread cutter on, and then using a hard felt buffing wheel to clean that. longtime viewers of my channel know, I absolutely despise those thread cutters. But I'm putting one on Sophie because she's not going to be living here. She's going to go someplace else.
I'm prepping screws to go to the bench motor, getting the worst of the crud off of them before I take them to the bench motor. The one that's in here is already cleaned. Now you see this little tiny one that's already cleaned. That's where these tools come in. These are my engineer pliers, my PZ56s and my PZ57s. Or I should say ours, because Liz uses these as well. What's cool about these is they're designed, they've got an end that are designed to hold screws. So if you don't happen to have a fancy bench motor like what we have, you can safely grasp the screw by the threads. Take your rotary tool and work your way around cleaning off crud or whatever. Now, I just knocked off some of the worst of that with the wire wheel. Can then take a buffing wheel on a rotary tool, and use this to safely hold the screw and get that screw head cleaned and polished. So I've mentioned these pliers before. I have recommended them highly in the past. I'll continue to recommend them highly because they really do work well. Now, like these countersunk heads on this, that's going to be difficult if I put that into the chuck on the bench motor to clean the back of it. So I just see all the crud that's on there. I'm sure you can see how cruddy that is. I'm just going to take a wire wheel and a rotary tool that knocked off all the nastiness. Now gripping the screw with the PZ56s. There you have it. This is a needle plate screw that is definitely worthy of going on a machine again. So yeah, these pliers are not cheap, but they're worth every penny that they cost. And when I say they're not cheap, I mean not cheap financially, but they're also not cheap in materials. They're Japanese made, and the Japanese tend to make extremely good hand tools. So, and they make other sizes too. We actually have another one of these that's a needle nose pliers. I believe it's over on Liz's bench right now, and quite honestly, I don't feel like going over there and looking for it. But I'll use this. This is the one of the for holding the back plate. I think this is for holding the back plate, or this is either that or the presser foot. Just going to hold that with these, get the nastiness off the backside. And that's just knocking off a lot of the big chunks. This I can actually do in the bench motor. But anyway, I'm just going through and I'm pre-cleaning some screws. Some I don't have to. I'm pre-cleaning some. This one, it's got quite a bit of schmoo on it, and the head is damaged. This I'm definitely going to do in the bench motor, and I'm going to show you that process in just a minute. Those screws are done. I don't have to touch those. There's some stuff in the tray here that hasn't been touched yet. One thing else you can do. You can use the small ones and you can grasp, like this washer that goes over the presser bar spring. You can grasp it, get the schmoo off, then move it, you know, 30 degrees or whatever, get the rest of the shmoo off, work it around. So these hold all sorts of parts really, really well. I cannot stress enough how important these pliers have become in our workflow, both here on the bench working on sewing machines and on Liz's bench working on clarinets, saxophones, flutes, etc., etc., ad nauseum. Liz is working on an alto saxophone now. That's what she's got on her bench. And I believe she has the needle nose version of these over there somewhere. Anyway, I'm going to get reset up. I'm going to take this stuff over to the bench motor, as well as this one here, because this is where the completed ones are going. All the small completed hardware goes in there. I was even able to use it to polish up the release pin for the upper thread tension assembly. You know, these things, they're just so great. You know, like I said, they're not cheap, but man, are they worthwhile spending the money on. All right, let me reset up at the bench motor, and we'll go through cleaning some of these screw heads up. It's a little cramped here now because I had to bring the camera over and an auxiliary light stand. So it's going to be a little difficult for me to do this and get it on camera. And I know I've shown this in the past. Okay, I've got, this is the screw that holds the stitch length regulator in place. Cleaning the shaft of that machine bolt or machine screw with some green Scotch-Brite pad while the motor spins at full tilt here. You see, that gets that shaft area nice and clean. So I'm going to start off. This is two different grits. I believe it's 220 and 320. So we'll start with the coarser side. Now you can do this in a drill. If you have a drill press, you can do it, definitely. You can do it with a hand drill even, or say an electric drill, like a portable, a cordless or whatever. You might need to have somebody operating the drill and holding it. This motor is running off of a foot switch. Oh, I'm sorry, this is a 600, a 400 and a 600 grit. 400 grit is here, 600 grits here, and then I'm going to promote that up. Actually, you know what? I'm going to take a fresh one of those. Okay. This starts out as 600, goes, excuse me, 600 is here, this black. It goes to 4,000 on the white and 12,000 on the gray. So, start out at the 6. Go to the 4,000. And flip it over and do the 12,000. Okay, now let's take a look at it. And you can see, at least I hope you can see, that that looks pretty darn good. Actually, I can't see anything because my monitor's on the other side of the room. Let's move the camera's viewfinder around a little bit. All right, we'll take another one. Okay, this is the bolt that is got the offset to it for the stitch for the feed dot rock shaft adjustment. You notice it's going to be spinning kind of wonky, right? That's okay. But I'm going to pulse it through. See if I got a little bit better piece of here, smaller piece of Scotch-Brite. Getting the Scotch-Brite on the shaft, holding it up there, and it gets a lot of the crud off of there. And once again, we're going to go through with the three sticks, starting with the 320 grit. Excuse me, the 220 grit. And we'll go to the 320.
we'll go to the 400, 600. We'll use this 600, even though it's kind of, we've already hit 600, we'll hit it again. We'll go to the 4000. And then the 12,000. And you'll be able to see. Now, granted, that was moving kind of wonky in the chuck, but it's only moving at about 1,700 RPMs in this case, so it's not that bad. But that cleaned up real nice. It can go into the completed pile. Take this one lightly, just gripping it lightly, not cranking it down, just lightly gripping on the threads is safe to do as long as you, once again, grip it lightly. I'm going to take Scotch-Brite to this initially, get some of the schmoo off of the shafting here. Scotch-Brite's our friend. There we go. All right, now I have a little narrower. I cut one of these down on my bandsaw out in the garage. I'm going to take a little bit of 400 grit and then some 600 just to get some of that other schmoo off of there. All right, we'll start with the 320, the 220, excuse me, 220. Work the head with the 220. We'll go to the 320. I'm doing this without even looking at that, but hit the 400. Try to keep it in motion. It gives more of a random scratch pattern, although with these kind of grits there's not much scratch. We'll go to the 6. Notice I'm doing the edge of the fastener as well as the face. And then pick up with the 6 on this, slightly hitting it. Go to the 4000. People are going to ask, where do I get these nail files? These are just standard manicurist nail files. I buy these at our local Sally's Beauty. The girls there laugh at me every time I go in and buy a bunch. There. Let's take a look and see what we got. Okay. And we still have some schmoo on here. All right. What happened? Oh, that's what happened. Hit an edge. All right. Well, we're going to clean that up. Once again, hit it lightly in the chuck. Should have cleaned that up. Like I said, once again, I'm in really confined space here. I can't see that. And that looks just fine. That looks great. Into the completeds. Next up, I'm going to do something that I hesitate to show. I'm going to put the stud for the upper thread tension in. I don't recommend you try this until you've got some experience doing this. I've got a stainless steel wire brush. Light pressure. Very, very lightly. I am not pressing on that at all. Just lightly letting the threads go over and get cleaned out by the wire brush. okay? Not jamming it on there, just lightly moving it across. I don't want to hear it if you try doing this and you screw this up, because this is a split piece here. If you screw that up and you bend it, it's because you jammed it in there. I don't want to hear it if you do that. I'm very, very lightly touching the Scotch-Brite to it. Once again, not jamming it. All right, now we'll go ahead. We'll go through the grits and clean the barrel. I've never shown this before. Like I said, I hesitate to show this because this could be a nightmare. This could make a lot of problems if you do this incorrectly. Too much pressure, you can make a mess out of this piece. But you'll note that looks superb. Look at that. Into the completed parts. Oops. We have a jumper. We have a jumper. Okay. This one. Once again. I'm going to use the stainless steel brush a little bit. Okay. Scotch-Brite, mostly to get the crud off the back. Bring this out just a little bit. Okay. Going in. Once again, very, very little pressure on this. Side. Take it to the 600 side. All right. Go to the 4000. End of the 12,000. Oops. There you go. Perfection. One thing I love about this Freeze bench motor, they are a little expensive. I will confess that. They run, I think, in the $600 range. Now, we've had this one for 30 years. We've got another one out in the other shop, too. It's a Dayton motor, which is fine. It's got a hollow shaft, but it also has this handbrake on it. So spinning, I can grab that and it turns it, it shuts, you know, it's great. It stops the motion really nicely. Doesn't hurt you. You can use it, like here, I'm just blipping it under power. It's great. I love this thing. All right, we're gonna get the shaft of this started up a little bit. It's going to take some of the schmoo off with this, with the Scotch-Brite, and then I'm going to take my narrowed 400-600 and just attack the shaft with that, with the 600 side. And why are we doing that? Because this is a pivot point. And that's going to help reduce friction. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why we use them. Let's hit the 400 side. Actually, you know what? This one's getting a little whooped. I am going to grab a fresh one of these. I buy these by a lot of these at a time. That was getting a little whooped. There's our 600. Make this one lightly. Go to the 4000. As you can tell, yeah, I don't use these things for manicure at all. And there we go. What do we got left? Oh, we got a few things here. Let's take something that's a little bit more challenging, something that's got a chowdered up head. This little one here, I don't know how well you can see that. The head is pretty chowdered. So what I'm going to do, putting it in, I've got one here that's 100 grit, 100 and 180. So we'll take the 100 grit side of this. We'll get the chowdering with the 100 grit. We'll go to the 180. Now we'll take a look at that. Yep, that got some of the chowdering off. There's still a little chowdering on this, on the outside edges. So hit those that chowdering here a little bit. Yep, that got rid of it. Go to the 180. Take a 320. That's me, a 220. 320. Go up to the 400. 600. Now the threads of this one are a little funky yet, but I'm going to use those engineer pliers, the PZ57s, to hold the head end of this while I take a wire wheel to the threads. Alright, let's take a look at that now. And there we go. How's that look? Looks considerably better in my eyes.
Well, there you go. We went deep into the weeds on a couple of items. A couple of items you've seen before, some stuff you have not. And I tried to keep this thing so it was going to be under an hour. I have failed miserably at that. So this is going to be probably one of the longer ones of this series. Anyway, there's a couple items I didn't show. And if you're wondering why, for example, you didn't see me cleaning the feed dog rock shaft or the connecting arm for the oscillating hook mechanism, it's because these items all went out to the garage where I've got a bench grinder with a 6-inch very fine wire wheel on it. At the moment, that shop is very difficult to maneuver in. It's very cluttered. The lighting isn't great, at least not for video. And one of my agenda items for this winter, hopefully, is to be able to get out there, get rid of a lot of the clutter that's there. I got a lot of crap that I've got to get rid of. And set up a station, because I've got a dedicated buffing machine and another bench motor out there. So my goal is to get most of the buffing and polishing out of this shop, with the exception of the stuff that I do with the rotary tool, all the big stuff I want to move out into the garage shop. Like I said, that is a goal. It's an agenda item. Whether I succeed at that goal or not, well, that remains to be seen. Anyway, I want to try to keep this relatively short, so I'm going to end this here. The next time we get back together again, we're going to be doing some more reassembly on Sophie. There's a couple items that I have not cleaned yet. I have not cleaned the bobbin case positioning bracket. I have not cleaned the bobbin case. And that's not going to happen until we have most of Sophie assembled, because there's no need to do it at this point. That will do as a separate entity. We'll have Sophie all timed and ready to go. So just before we put her bobbin case positioning bracket and bobbin case back in, that's going to be when we disassemble and clean that. And I've shown that in the past, but that will be a completely separate episode. So anyway, thank you so much for watching, and we will see you on the next one.